My wife and I congratulate all those who have worked so hard for this event and have great pleasure in declaring the Glasgow Garden Festival 1988 open.
April 1988. An historic moment as His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales launches the Glasgow Garden Festival. A festival which will become the pride of the Clyde and all Scotland. As the balloon went up, all Scotland knew this was no utopian dream, but reality. Glasgow was coming up roses. This is the story of the city which challenged and embraced the tide of change. The Garden Festival would take place on the banks of the River Clyde, the great progenitor, the nation's industrial artery for two centuries. A river of great history, once alive with vessels. Ferries crammed with horses and carts, vans and trucks, and the people of Glasgow. Rich with their own heady combination of wisdom, warmth and wit. Streetwise people, ready to tackle and laugh at the ups and downs of life's slipways. Glasgow, never pretentious, always a working city. A city of ingenious people, able to engineer good humour for every occasion, and, at work, to engineer for the demands of the world. People capable of exploiting every conceivable industrial or commercial opportunity. Little wonder that the qualities of pride, strength, survival and determination were every day. They were qualities which were needed during the lean years as smokestack cities across the Western world watched and felt the tremors of the advancing sunrise technologies. But the same determination and will to compete was there as Glasgow set its sights on the future, determined to dust itself down, polish itself up, and put the heart back in the city. The city, of course, already had a distinguished record in staging major events. It was the home of the great Empire Exhibition, that extraordinary extravaganza of the 1930s.
Scene changes to Westminster Hall, London, where a great concourse of members of Parliament, diplomats and peers is gathered to hear the Prime Minister and Mr. Attlee. The subject is the Scottish Exhibition, of which Mr. Attlee, to invert the order of the speeches, says...
It was, I think, a particularly happy decision to hold the Empire Exhibition in Scotland.
Well, as you know, we're here to preview an event which to some of you may seem doubly remote. First of all, because it's happening in Glasgow. And secondly, it's happening in 3 years' time from now. But the National Garden Festival 1988 is destined to be Britain's event of that year.
Glasgow's vitality was about to crystallise in a huge 120-acre garden setting. The city had spruced itself up. Glasgow was ready for the royal stamp of approval. 100 years earlier, a prince and princess of Wales had visited the dear green place. Now, a great-great-grandson and his princess were to formally open the Glasgow Garden Festival 1988. They were greeted by 5,000 children from Scottish Opera for Youth and from 81 schools throughout Strathclyde. They were joined too by 45,000 season ticket holders who helped to create the country's biggest ever pageant. The Clydeside was alive, a spectacle of riverboats, colour, music, smiling faces and nostalgia as the Prince and Princess of Wales journeyed by tram along the festival esplanade. A wonderful scene. The children of Falkirk Youth Theatre inviting the royal couple to reach out and touch somebody's hand. And from Leslie Ann Thompson, age 9, a gift for the two royal princes back home. A special moment too for the festival's oldest season ticket holder, Miss Minnie McGregor, aged 96. And the flip side of the festival, where their Royal Highnesses had a preview of how 500,000 people would shake, rattle and roll through the 5 months of Glasgow's Soar Away success. A festival of contrasts indeed. The mysterious Crystal Pavilion, a fantasy building where crystals, the foundation of today's technology, would grow before your very eyes. Smiling faces. People waving and greeting the royal couple on their walkabout to the Hugh Fraser Tropicarium. A fascinating insight into the world of plants and insects. Exotic plants rich with nectar for the brilliantly coloured butterflies. Flower power from the air and on the ground. The prince and princess board the Royal Barouche, complete with Greys, Disco and Ben, for the next stage of their journey in this bonny Clyde wonderland. Past the beautifully restored Overton Bandstand, blue and gold in a sea of vivid colour, as the Grand Parade makes its way down the recreated Victorian High Street to the Rendezvous at the hub of the festival's 6 theme sectors. The pipes and drums of the Strathclyde Police Band lead the procession. And for just a few fleeting moments, everyone is lost in make-believe. Is this really a fairy tale dream, complete with a prince and princess? How difficult now to recall the derelict, abandoned dockland of only 3 years previous. And from the hustle and bustle of the crowded thoroughfares to a moment of quiet reflection in the festival's walled garden, before setting off at a trot through the landscape and scenery of Scotland. Past waterfall and highland burn, loch and meadow, to the lowlands and the water's edge. and a change of transport to cross the festival harbour. A sea of activity as the Prince and Princess of Wales make their way on the Festival Belle, a Mississippi paddle steamer, complete with New Orleans jazz band. And all round ship's siren sound, sailing dinghies bob on the waves, and thousands greet the royals from the quayside. On land again, and in the distance, the Clydesdale Bank Anniversary Tower, standing sentinel over the festival. 240 feet of spinning top, rising needle-like towards the sky. Scotland's towering event symbolized by a towering achievement. There were many, in more ways than one, banking on the success of the tower. After the royals, a million more would join Glasgow and Scotland in reaching for the sky. Having viewed the city in spectacular fashion, the royal couple completed their festival journey by miniature railway, passing exhibits from Lancashire, the Red Rose County, Columbus, Ohio, home of the USA's 1992 Ameriflora, and Gateshead, which will host the National Garden Festival in 1990. And when he arrived at the opening ceremony, Prince Charles was convinced that Glasgow was on the right track.
My wife and I are delighted to be in Scotland today to officially open the Glasgow Garden Festival. If anyone needed reminding that Glasgow's miles better, this event must represent yet another milestone in the renaissance of this great city. It equally represents a milestone for urban regeneration in our country. A remarkable change has been achieved in developing a derelict riverbank into a magnificent living park. So tellingly evoked, I think, by the folk songs of Adam McNaughton. I can't resist quoting one of them with apologies for failing to do justice to the dialect. Oh, where is the Glasgow where I used to stay? We white woolly closes done up with pipe clay. Where ye knew all your neighbours frae first floor to third, and to keep your door locked was considered absurd. Do you know the folks living upstairs for you? Or where is the wee shop where I used to buy a quarter of tatties and a fourpenny pie? A bag of broken biscuits and three soddy scones. And the women, they asked, how's your man getting on? In this way, and by such an example, Glasgow may once again give us cause to recall Daniel Defoe's description of it 250 years ago, as the cleanest and beautifulest and best-built city in Britain. My wife and I congratulate all those who have worked so hard for this event and have great pleasure in declaring the Glasgow Garden Festival 1988 open.
Lift-off for the Glasgow Garden Festival. A royal send-off on a truly royal occasion. And as the voices of the Glasgow Youth Choir joined with those from the kilted scouts of the Glasgow Gang Show, thousands raised their eyes to the sky. Fireworks boomed, streamers scattered against the skyline, and 30,000 balloons drifted into the air. Scotland's Festival of Festivals was underway. Across the nation, the message would spread. Around the globe, satellites would transmit pictures and programs for the world's media. In the next 5 months, the white-knuckle ride would twist and roll and coast and corkscrew with 500,000 daredevil passengers. The tower would rise effortlessly and treat over 1 million visitors to a unique view of Glasgow and beyond. The trams and trains would shunt and shake and shuggle with a million passengers each. 9,000 performers, some professional, many amateur, would descend upon the festival to bring together the very best of gardens and horticulture with the art, history and heritage of Scotland. 2.5 million people would cross the spectacular Bell's Bridge. 1.25 million tourists would flock to the festival from around the world. And when the fireworks finally burned out 5 months later, they showed that a record-breaking 4,345,820 visits had been made. This is the new Glasgow. Things are coming up roses. Glasgow, through the Garden Festival, also demonstrated that you can put the heart back in the city.